Thank you very much for joining this webinar. In today's session, we talk about the seismic inversion with the option for managing the interbed multiple modeling. My name is Thibaut de Fromaville. I'm a geophysicist, part of the consulting team of Beicip-Franlab. If you have any questions regarding our activity, you can contact us via our website. We have a contact form at beicip.com/contact. A few guidelines before we start the webinar. So all attendees are automatically muted during the webinar. If you have any questions during the presentation, there is a question panel in the Livestorm window, and we will answer them during the Q&A breaks at the end of the presentation. If we don't have time to address all questions, we'll answer them afterwards by email. Our software InterWell is used for seismic inversion and reservoir characterization. The first step of this process is QC of the data, of well data and seismic data. This involves well data conditioning, QC of seismic data for extracting the signal, conditioning of gathers, conditioning of post and pre-stack seismic data, and AVO study. For seismic inversion, we have several offers depending on the type of data you have in your study and the goal you want to have for reservoir characterization. In today's session, we'll focus on the acoustic model-based inversion and the option for interbed multiples modeling. Following the seismic inversion, there are different options for reservoir characterization, computing different attributes, extracting maps for including them in the geological model, and dedicated workflows for fracture network characterization. I will now start with the presentation of a study in which we have applied our methodology. I will first describe the study, and then I will give you an explanation of the methodology for IBMM. Our study is contaminated with multiple reflection. We have a seismic 3D volume that is contaminated with current interbed multiple reflection, the events at the Mara Jurassic gas reservoir from 2 to 2.5 seconds in the seismic data, suffers from a poor resolution and interbed multiple reflection. These multiples, they have the same velocities as the primaries, and they cannot be adequately attenuated during the pre-processing of the seismic data. Therefore, the acoustic impedance that we can predict with such seismic data is significantly affected by the multiples. In our study, we have 13 Jurassic wells, which are going to be used for well-to-seismic calibration and the initial model building. And we also have 6 blind test wells for checking the results. In order to overcome the difficulty and the quality of our seismic data, we'll perform a seismic inversion with management of interbed multiples in order to reduce the multiple contamination, improve interpretation, and improve the characterization of fracture and porosity. Let's start with the first step, which is for seismic data QC. There's a dedicated tool for seismic data QC in InterWell, which is called multi-trace coherence analysis. First, we have extracted a signal-to-noise ratio in our seismic volume. We have seen that this ratio is quite stable from the Cretaceous to the Jurassic. Also, this ratio is slightly increasing with the depth from 9 to 10%. These results, they do indicate that we have a low amount of random noise. Regarding the detected seismic band path, above the 2000 milliseconds, which is above the Gottner formation, we have a band path of 9 to 65 Hertz. And this band path is decreasing to a range between 9 and 48 Hertz between 2000 milliseconds and 3000 milliseconds. We interpret this decrease in the seismic band path due to the attenuation of the high frequencies in the large thick beds of salt and anhydrite intercalation in the Gottner formation. All in all, we have an average good seismic data in the quality of seismic data in terms of the level of random noise and the frequency content. However, we have an important contamination with interbed multiples, and this will require specific manipulation during the inversion. And this is what I'm going to detail in the following slides. The second type of QC is the QC of well data, and preparation of well data. So the IBMM technique is going to model the impulse response of the primaries and interbed multiples at two stages in our process. First, at the well to seismic calibration, and then this option is also present in the inversion stages. The calibration and generation of such response is going to require that the well impedance data is available from the shallowest multiple generator down to the base of the target. In our study, however, for the Jurassic wells, they do not have the well data at the Cretaceous levels. This is why we had to reconstruct this information using the other wells. This is the process which is detailed on the right-hand slide of my slide, the reconstruction of the missing impedance information for these Jurassic wells. First, we have performed seismic inversion of the Cretaceous only based on the Cretaceous wells. Then we have extracted the inverted impedance logs for the Jurassic wells location. We have prolongated these logs using the inverted impedances. And then using the prolongated logs for the Jurassic wells, we have been able to perform well to seismic calibration and the seismic inversion with the interbed multiple management and targeting the Jurassic part. Let me detail the IBMM methodology that has been used first in the well to seismic calibration and then during the inversion process. As a simplification, let's first detail the hypothesis we have in the 1D medium. So we suppose that this medium is made of a series of homogeneous layers. We have different layers. In each layer, we have an impedance sigma, and we in the layer I, so we have sigma zero and sigma one in our schematic down below the slide. For each layer, it is located between two travel tide depths, xi and xi plus one, and the thickness into a time of each layer is going to be the sampling rate of the seismic. In our drawing, we have a downgoing wave with an amplitude v0, which is arriving at the time depth x0 at the time zero. This downgoing wave is reflected on the interface x1 as a wave with amplitude u1, and it is also transmitted through this interface as a wave with an amplitude v1. The additional hypothesis we have is that we don't have any upgoing wave is going to be involved in the reflection and transmission at the interface level. At the second interface, this reflected wave v1 is going to be reflected as a wave. A transmitted wave V1 is going to be reflected as a wave with amplitude U2 at the interface X2. It's going to be transmitted as a wave with an amplitude V2. And also, we don't have any upgoing wave involved in the reflection transmission at the X2 level. So this is for the propagation in the 1D media. We can now generalize for multiple layers in order to model all internal reflections and transmissions. So we have a wave Vig, which is going down layer I at a travel time depth Xi and to a time Tj. And we have the different impedances for each layers. The equations involved in the calculation of the amplitudes of reflected and transmitted waves are detailed in this slide. So we consider a layer I, and we want to calculate the reflected and transmitted waves amplitudes at a two-way time Tj. And we estimate these from the waves at the two-way time Tj minus one. So we have our matrix representation for the calculation of these amplitudes. The new element in these equations is R, which is the reflectivity at depth Xi. This reflectivity is calculated by the ratio of differences of the impedances at the layer I and the layer I minus one. So we obtain a series of values uig of reflected waves for the even values of j, which corresponds to the impulse response with the internal multiples. There are two ways for calculating the synthetic traces, either by convolution of the impulse response with the wavelet, or by using directly the wavelet amplitudes to initialize a series of the amplitudes of the transmitted waves. We have applied this process to the Cretaceous formation, following on the process I've described earlier. We have a 3D-based acoustic model-based inversion targeting the Cretaceous series that has been run based only on the Cretaceous wells. So we have used these wells for well-to-seismic calibration, the wavelet extraction, and constructing the initial low-frequency model. This initial low-frequency model is going to integrate the seismic interpretation and well data. It integrates the seismic interpretation with the seismic horizons I've interpreted on the full stack of seismic, and the definition of deposition modes. They are actually used as guide for extrapolating the well data in the entire volume. Therefore, we have an initial volume of acoustic impedance, which is then going to be used as an input of the seismic inversion. The second step, once we have performed this type of inversion using a Cretaceous wells, is the reconstruction of the Jurassic wells, which were missing the information in the Cretaceous part. This is what's represented in the slide. We have the two initial Jurassic wells that are missing the top part in the Cretaceous part, and we have used the results from the Cretaceous inversion to prolongate these logs of acoustic impedance. So we have generated composite logs, and we will include the possible multiple generators in the Cretaceous series when we perform the IBMM well to seismic calibration targeting the Marat formation. This is what we perform in the next step. We first, using these Jurassic wells, we're going to perform a well to seismic calibration. We require different tests to identify the correct interval in which to perform the well to seismic calibration. Indeed, we have tested different possible generators, different possible beginning of the interval for generating the multiples. We have tested the log length and then the beginning of different formations. Looking at the results above different tests, we have obtained the best matching synthetic data, starting the Interbed multiple generation from the Hartar formation. So the option in the software in the acoustic wavelet estimation is an option quite easy to do in here. You just select the option for generating the synthetic with multiples. You select your markers and the beginning and the end of the interval in which you want to perform the well to seismic calibration. For all the available wells, the IBMM calibration has shown a significant improvement of the match in position and energy of events between the synthetic traces and the seismic data, compared to the standard method without IBMM. Then we have constructed an initial model. We have performed a full field inversion with the IBMM option. Again, we had to do several tests to select the best set of parameters, which gives us the best match with the synthetic data and the well data. The option in the seismic inversion is also straightforward in here. You just need to select the enable interbed multiple management when you select the parameters for your model-based inversion. Regarding the results of our inversion, we have seen several benefits for characterization and interpretation. First, we have a seismic data enhancement, attenuation of random noise, and increase of seismic resolution. Moreover, we have a corresponding synthetic seismic with attenuated multiples. Energy was better matching the expected pattern. The inverted acoustic impedance is also showing a stronger lateral continuity with an attenuated impact of multiples. In the impedance results of the inversion using IBMM, we have been able to track on the inversion results the low impedance benches that we can identify in the middle Marat formation. We also had other benefits for the interpretation and characterization in the identification of high impedance contrast. For example, in the anhydrite salt in the Gottner formation, they are now clear and present. We have been able to identify an impedance kick in the Najma formation. Also, a better identification of the entrance of the top Marat formation, which corresponds to an increase in impedance in our study. Let's check the results on a cross-section in an example and comparison without and with IBMM. So we have seen an enhancement of the lateral continuity of events obtained away from the structures and in between the wells. The two wells in this cross-section are the left and right-hand side with the acoustic impedance log in color. In particular, We have seen an enhancement of the lateral continuity of the low impedance bench, starting 20 milliseconds below the mid-malformation. We have seen an attenuated impact of the multiples on the cross-section below, which is using the IBMM option during the inversion. We have extracted maps in time in between two horizons, the mid-marat at plus 20 milliseconds and the mid-marat formation plus 80 milliseconds. Also in these maps, we can see that without and with the option of IBMM, we can identify and the low impedance benches are shown a stronger lateral continuity and are more easily identified in this map compared to the map without the IBMM option. Now let's check the QC at the wells. On the left-hand side of my slide, you have a comparison of the results of the inversion, which are the black curves for two wells. You have the initial impedance logs in color. And we can compare on the left the results for the IBMM option and on the right the log without the IBMM option. What we observe is an improvement of the correlation from 75 to 89%. So we have a better prediction of the impedance with the IBMM option. When we perform the interpretation on the result of the inversion, we observe the different benefits that I have explained earlier in my slide with the cross section and the map section. In addition to these observations, we observe that the wells which have information for the deeper series are showing a greater enhancement in the match between the acoustic impedance after inversion and the measured impedance. So this means that this technique can still be used for even deeper targets. Another QC that we have performed is with the blind wells. If you remember, we had 6 blind wells in our study. We have used them as blind tests. Again, the results of the inversion are the black curve and the measured impedance is in color. We have a good match. We have 86% of correlation in the interval that we have chosen. We have a good prediction, which is obtained with these blind wells, even with the blind wells that were away from the different structures in which the calibration wells were present. These results are giving us a higher confidence in the inversion results. As a conclusion, the IBMM technique is modeling the impulse response of the primaries and the interbed multiples at the well-to-seismic calibration and the inversion stages. So this seismic inversion with the IBMM option is reducing the multiple contaminations and is improving the seismic characterization and also seismic interpretation. In terms of interpretation, we have a synthetic seismic data with reduced noise, also acoustic impedance that is benefiting from the attenuation of multiples. Also, these acoustic impedance results could be used as a guide when we performed an elastic inversion. For example, it could be used in the QC or in the selection of the parameters of this elastic inversion when comparing the results of the inversion in terms of acoustic impedance and this acoustic impedance obtained with the IBMM option. This concludes my presentation. Now, if you have any questions, there is a question panel in the Livestorm section. This kind of technique for reducing the multiples during the seismic inversion is not meant to entirely replace the corrections of multiples and the correction of multiples during the pre-processing. In our study, there was a pre-processing meant to reduce the multiples, but still after this pre-processing, we still had some multiples amplitude left. And so this comes in addition to this process in order to remove this impact during the seismic inversion. Also, I would like to emphasize the importance of the feasibility study at the wells. So this is a process that can be performed using measurements at the wells. You can compute the acoustic reflection coefficients with the multiples and actually check with your well measurements if this kind of modeling is possible and you will benefit from this kind of modeling in your inversion. I would like to thank you all for attending this meeting and see you for another webinar. Thank you very much.